Now, the last third or quarter of mechanics is on this unit called SHM, symbol harmonic motion. And basically, the whole of SHM is to do with the motion of this cart. So if you haven't already done so, I'd like you just to spend a little bit of time contemplating the motion of this cart. I almost guarantee nobody could probably do it just yet. If you can, I'll give you a free burst when we get back into class. Describe as in-depth as possible the motion of this cart. Do you think it's traveling the same speed? Do you think the forces are changing? Do you think it's accelerating? Do you think the velocity is changing? If so, when, where, how? Yep, so spend some time having a go at that. Lockdown does make me a little bit sad because I'd normally spend, I don't know, the best part of a week unpacking this and teasing these ideas out. And because it's in a video, I just basically tell the answer, which is a little bit sad. So again, we've got the same mass moving on a frictionless surface with a spring attached. And this animation essentially tells you the answer. So what are we noticing here? Is the speed constant? And so if you're looking at the size of the purple arrow, you're seeing that the speed is constantly changing. And it is a maximum in one place and a minimum in another. See if you can figure that out. You're noticing that the displacement is constantly changing. If the velocity is constantly changing, then you know that something must be happening. For velocity to be changing, that means there must be an acceleration. If there's an acceleration, that means there has to be an unbalanced force. And so we're going to play with all of these ideas. So you see that there's a spring, and so that should immediately make you think of Hooke's law, F equals negative kx, where the k is the spring constant. And so you're seeing that as x gets bigger, the force must also get bigger. And so it must also be accelerating the most when you have the largest change in x. You're also seeing that the velocity is the greatest when x is zero. So we have the largest accelerations at both ends when we have the largest change in velocity, because the velocity is going from positive to negative, and so the largest change in velocity is at each end. So the velocity is actually zero at each end, and the velocity is maximum in the center. We're seeing acceleration is maximum at both ends and zero in the center. So we're seeing this motion is changing over time. So is that what you would have expected? Is that what your description was? Now, if I was to get you to draw the displacement over time, what do you think it would look like? Is it a straight line? Is it a zigzag line? Is it a sine curve? Is it a negative sine curve? Is it some other graph? What do you think the displacement over time looks like? Again, lockdown makes me sad. I'd normally make you tease it out and draw some graphs and come up on the board and have a go, and we'd unpack around those ideas. Today, I'm just going to hit play, and we see that this beautiful sinusoidal curve that they say it's simple. I wouldn't really call that simple, but it does follow this lovely, elegant sine curve. And so you're seeing that actually the displacement, or the rate of change of displacement, changes because it's accelerating, getting to its maximum point of acceleration. And so we're seeing that velocity is constantly changing because acceleration is constantly changing. And that's why we're getting these beautiful sinusoidal curves. And we could say that is a y equals a sine omega t graph, if you wanted to get all fancy, and we'll get onto that later. So now we've got the same model again. This time we've got the acceleration vectors on it, and so you can see the acceleration is maximum at maximum amplitude and minimum at the center. If you were to draw an acceleration versus position graph, how do you think that looks? So if we go back to what we were looking at before, we said at maximum displacement, it has maximum acceleration because of Hooke's law, F equals negative kx. What do you think that's going to look like on a graph? Have a think about it. Pause the video. What have you come up with? Again, I just click play, and you get a straight line, not a sine graph. Is this weird? Well, not really, because you've got F equals negative kx and F and A, F equals ma, so depending on the mass of the system. So basically, you've got A is proportional to X, so A is proportional to displacement. That's exactly what you're getting. You're getting a perfect straight line because the further you extend it, the more acceleration there is, the more restoring force there is towards the center. And so that begins to get us to this definition of what is simple harmonic motion. So let's have a look at that. To define what simple harmonic motion is, it might be easier just to go over a few examples. So a pendulum, so that's going to be this week's task. Can you work out the period of a pendulum? A ruler vibrating on a bench. So you're trying to think through what have all these things got in common and what do they relate to what I've just said. So a spring, we'll just spend a bunch of time looking at springs. A needle in a sewing machine. A string on a guitar roughly approximates a torsional pendulum. A fence bouncing on a trampoline while still in contact. What have they all got together? Well, simple harmonic motion is periodic motion. So periodic means in the same period. So it takes the same amount of time to repeat the motion endlessly. So it's a repetitive motion that occurs with the same amount of time. Which occurs around an equilibrium position. So it has to have a position about which it goes through. So we notice that in the spring when we're watching it go up and down, there was a restoring force towards the center. So simple harmonic motion is periodic motion which occurs around an equilibrium position. The acceleration and therefore the force called the restoring force, because it's always towards the center, it's not just down or up, it's always towards the center, is directly proportional to the displacement. So as you get further from the center or further from the equilibrium, the more that force is acting. The linear restoring force is one that gets progressively larger with displacement. So this idea of linear, so simple harmonic motion is linear, it's in a straight line. And so these are ideas that we've just seen in the video. That maximum acceleration at every end is zero in the middle, and maximum speed in the middle and zero speed on the outside, and maximum displacement at the two extremes by definition. The best example of is a spring. The more you stretch the spring, the larger the force trying to get the spring back to its original shape. The restoring force and therefore the acceleration of the mass is always proportional to the displacement from the equilibrium, and that's what we saw in those animations, and you can play with them soon. The further an object moves from the equilibrium, the greater restoring force. And so it must follow a straight line or nearly so, and so that's why we say a pendulum approximates it when it's less than 10 degrees. The velocity is always changing, the acceleration is always changing, the time period isn't, the time period is fixed, and can be driven, and the damping is when it kind of loses amplitude over time. So losing amplitude is fine because the period is the same because it's periodic motion, but it will ultimately have zero amplitude, will ultimately not bounce anymore. Hooke's law, F equals negative kx, is what I referred to. The larger the force, or the larger the extension x, the larger the force. And this is stealing the thunder. Like, I spend two periods getting to this point. It's a little bit sad. We can approximate one-dimensional simple harmonic motion is circular motion, which links to what we've just done with rotational stuff, and then we can link it to a whole bunch of other things. And yeah, that kind of steals the thunder. We'll see if we can get there next week. That's a brief overview of SHM. The two equations that I'm going to get you to play with this week is T equals 2 pi L over G, so the length to the center of mass of a pendulum is related to gravity G of 9.81 by this formula for period. And this equation here, T equals 2 pi m mass divided by k, the spring constant. So this is the period for a mass oscillating on a spring, and this is the period for a mass moving as a pendulum. And yeah, we're going to play with those ideas out of SciPad this week. The Lord's blessing. Cheers.